Good morning, everyone.
Here and out in TV land. We thank you so much for coming. It's still a sunshiny day and bright. It's the Lord's Day. Is there any announcements we need to make today? Okay. I'll get right into the opening. Today I'm opening scripture with Hebrews 10, verses 11 through 17. And every priest stands ministering daily, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. From that time, waiting till his enemies are made his footstool, for by one offering he has perfected those forever who are being sacrificed. But the Holy Spirit also witnesses to us, for after he had said this before, this is the covenant that I will make with those, will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts and into their minds. I will write them. And then he adds, their sins, their lawless deeds, I will remember no more. Now where there is remission in these, there is no longer an offering for sin. Let us pray. O gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you. We give thanks that you have done so much in our lives. We still have the freedom. Lord, we have the freedom, especially now, since your Son sacrificed his life for our sins in the future, in the present, and days gone by. Lord, these will never be brought up again. And Lord, we thank you that you have such an open heart. There are so many people hurting, our children that go to school, our everyday lives, and the older people that with this pandemic have been shut out. Their lives have been stopped. Their families could not visit them. Lord, we thank you so much that you have made this possible through broadcasting and that we still can have prayer and community. We can get together even with the rules and regulations that we have to abide by. Lord, there is someone that is really hurting this day. There are thousands of people that are hurting. You've been knocking on their door. May today be the day that they open the door. It provides the everlasting life. It provides freedom. And Lord, we thank you so much for these blessings that your Son was able to sacrifice and give us each day. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We have a song, Forever.
Thank you.
Good morning. Time for prayers and praises. Who's got something?
Roger.
Betty McGregor texted me this morning, and she's finally able to have visitors. Limited time, I guess. But that's a praise for her, so I'm sure she's gone through a lot.
If everybody didn't hear, Betty McGregor can now have visitors. So after over a year, I can just imagine not being able to really see somebody, so what a praise. Lisa?
I put on a Facebook prayer request. A friend of mine, her baby is in Albany. They're up in Albany. He's got multiple issues. He's about 2 months old, and they're not sure what is going on. They sent him off there to be tested for muscular dystrophy. I don't know if that's it or not, but he's doing something. So just pray for healing, pray for wisdom, and the parents are not strong believers, so I would really like prayers that they would strengthen their faith and that this would be a way for God to use that.
So Lisa just has a prayer for a friend. Friend's babies in Albany, a couple months old, going through some tests, trying to figure out what's going on. I'll throw out a couple praises. If everybody didn't see, Joshua Bima came home, I believe it was Wednesday, and they had a big parade. The fire department was involved, I saw on Facebook. But again, I can just imagine the happiness that they're going through to finally have their child home after all this time. Another praise, I see a couple new faces today. Larry and Sue, glad to have you back after all this time. You're speechless, Larry? Larry's lost for words. Glad to have you. Bev. So Bev has prayers from her daughter Belle for a coworker child. Grandchild. Issues really aren't known, but just being, you know, just have prayers in your mind and in your heart for that family. And also Bev's oldest daughter just healing after a fall, and I think she just had surgery. So just prayers that nothing happened when she did fall. Go ahead.
My mom has a back surgery.
And your mom's name again is?
Lillian.
Lillian. Be thinking of the Estels today as mother's going to have surgery. Lillian is her name. Anyone else? Continue to pray for Pastor Andy and his family. Abby, any updates?
It's going pretty good for what it is. Is he behaving?
Mom's keeping him in line. I'd be more worried about Danny saying something to him than, you know, Mom saying something to him.
So for everybody didn't hear in TV land, we're just keeping Andy and the family in our prayers. Andy behaves. Maggie keeps him in line. And everybody else. I do know that I did hear that he's standing 5'6" again. So last I heard, he's actually at his height, pretty much straight, which is a praise, but a lot of time still to go. Anyone else? Well, let's go to prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day so we can gather together, coming as one. We lift up these people, Betty McGregor, for visitors finally after a long year. Friends of people at work with sick children. Sick children that have come home after a long, almost year, to be home with their family. I can just imagine the changes in that family's life, not running to Syracuse every day, thinking of will everything be all right. So just keep the Bimas in your thoughts and prayers. Happy that old friends are back at church today to be with us. It's been a long year. We still have a long ways to go, but hopefully we're getting over that hump. Keep with Pastor Andy and his family. Still a long road. I can just imagine having to sit idle. So just be with him, knowing not to do things that he shouldn't, just so he heals and then he's back among us, leading us. Be with our minister today as he brings us the word that we'll learn more about you, Jesus. Enjoy your Sunday, your families, because we know things can change in an instant. In his most precious name, amen.
Thank you. everybody. I hope everyone had a great Easter, and for those that were at school at Edmeston, I hope you had a great week off. I know my kids enjoyed not being at school and getting to see some family, so that was great. My name is Ethan Cook. I do campus ministry with an organization called Campus 180. I do ministry at Mohawk Valley Community College, and I've been doing campus ministry for 15 years. And before that, I was a computer programmer at Brockport. And so that's going to come into play in a second. So I do campus ministry, and with college students, I don't like to just lecture to them or preach to them because they sit in class all day. Am I too close, too far away? Okay. And so I don't want to just give them information. So I like to ask questions. I like them to think. So I have a few questions for you guys to think about as I start. If you were going to be a missionary and you're going to go to a foreign land and you could only take the Old Testament or the New Testament, which one would you take? New? I was in seminary, and in there I had a guy who loved the Old Testament. And he would say, you can't understand the New Testament if you don't understand the Old Testament. And I'd say, that's true, but you're not going to see Jesus in the completeness without the New Testament. So if you notice, the Gideons, right, they've answered that question. They give everyone a little itty-bitty Bible, especially to young people. And they go around, and it's the Gideon Bible, so they've got the New Testament, and they also figured they could include Psalms and Proverbs. So just a question to think about. The next question would be, if you could only bring one book of the entire Bible with you, which book would you bring?
John.
So a gospel, we've got John. I know a lot of people think Romans. Romans would be the book to bring with you. And so I don't think there's one specific answer. Today we're going to be looking at Acts, and we're going to see why Acts is very important. So let's say you went to that foreign land, and miraculously one of them could read the Bible, read English. Let's say we had English or we had it in their language, they could read it. And you only had the New Testament, but you did not have the book of Acts. Let's say you didn't have the book of Acts. You'd read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, four accounts, eyewitnesses of Jesus. You'd really understand who Jesus is, and you flip the page and you'd all of a sudden have an author for almost the rest of the New Testament that you've never heard of before. Paul, who's Paul? Why is he going to prison in Rome? What is going on? So if you don't have the book of Acts in the New Testament, you're going to have a lot of more confusion than you might without it. So we're going to be looking at the book of Acts today. Acts is a very powerful book, and the more archaeological and historical evidence we find, we realize that, wow, Acts is actually quite historically accurate. Originally, people thought that it wasn't. It was probably just written later, but the events that take place in Acts give us within 1 or 2 years of where we think it must have been finished by about 61 AD. And so the book of Acts has a lot of historicity in it. It tells us how the first churches were started and how the gospel originally spread. The book of Acts gives us examples of missionaries. Paul goes on four different journeys, and so we see him going out and spreading the word. The book of Acts also tells us about a certain main character. So first, if I said, if you read the book of Acts, who's the main character? Most people are going to say Paul, right? That's what we learn about Paul in chapter 6 on his road to Damascus. He gets Saul, right? And then his name is changed to Paul. And then we see him do some awesome things. And I want to say, wait, I think there's a more important character, and that's the Holy Spirit. And so Baptists, we don't often talk about the Holy Spirit. At least for me growing up, it was we knew it, we believe in it, but it wasn't talked about a lot. So next week, I'm going to be in Acts chapter 2, and so we're going to talk a lot more about the Holy Spirit next week. I'm excited, and I hope you are, because that is the gift that was promised in chapter 1, which we're going to go over today. So have you ever been in limbo? So coronavirus puts us in limbo for people that maybe couldn't have visitors. Someone couldn't have a visitor for a year. You're waiting. Or maybe you've been waiting and praying on a decision, and how long do you wait? How long do you pray for someone? Jacob, if I'm getting it right, sorry, he worked how many years for his wife? That's right, there we go. So, the one he wanted originally was 14 years, right? He was willing to wait 14 years. Moses waited, how many years did they wait in the desert? 40 years he waited in the desert. So the disciples, we're going to read in Acts 1, are with Jesus, and he says he's going to come back. How long is that? Right, we're still waiting 2,000 years later, so they're in limbo, and we're in limbo, and we're going to look at a few different instances or reactions to what we should or should not be doing while we wait for his return. So I'm going to pray, and then we'll go ahead and read through chapter 1 and discuss it. So dear Lord, we thank you for last week's celebration of your resurrection, the ultimate miracle that you conquered death, we just praise you for that, and we pray that we don't just put all of our decorations away and then bring them out a year from now, that we can think and be encouraged and excited by who you are and what you've done and what you still want to do in our life today. We just ask you would be with us in our time this morning. In your name, amen. All right, so I'm going to read the entire chapter, and then we will go back and go a little bit section by section. So I recently got a new Bible. I think I mentioned that before, but it's large print, but I still can barely read out it. So I printed it in like size 30 so that we can go from there. But you can read up there. We're the ESV version. In the first book, O Theopolis, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up, after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. He presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, "You heard from me, John baptized with water, but you will be baptized by the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the time or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the very ends of the earth." And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took them out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven, as he went, behold, two men stood there in white robes and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." Verse 12, then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. And when they had entered, they went up to the upper room where they were staying. Peter and John, James, Andrew, Philip, and Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, the good Judas, son of James. All these were with one accord, were devoting themselves to prayer, together with the woman and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. In those days, Peter stood among the brothers. The company of the persons was in all about 120. And he said, "Brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke beforehand by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in the ministry. Now this man acquired a field with the reward of his wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open the middle, and all of his bowels gushed out. And it became known to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, so that the field was called in their own language El Kadama, that is, field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, 'May his camp become desolate, and let there be no one to dwell in it, and let another take his office.' So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day he was taken up from us, one of these men must become with us a witness to his resurrection." And they put forward two, Joseph called Barsabbas, not Barabbas, right? That was a couple weeks ago. Barsabbas, who was also called Justice, and another one called Matthias. And they prayed and said, "You, Lord, who know the hearts of all, show which one of these you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. All right, so we're going to go back to the beginning. We're going to look at the first section. And he says, "In this book, O Theopolis," and I wish we could spend a lot more time on chapter 1. We're going to speed up through this. "I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach." And so in the first book, does anyone know what the first book is? So there's a certain book that is the first book. It's one of the four Gospels. So it's a Luke. So we're assuming that Luke, by the literary evidence, that it's the same author that wrote Luke, and this is the second book. And so he mentions the Holy Spirit right away. And so Theopolis is mentioned first, and then Jesus, and then the Holy Spirit, right in the second verse. "Until the day when he was taken up, after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles which he had chosen." Continue on to verse 3. "He presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God." So in the book of John, we have at least three times he's with the 12 disciples. The third time he's on the beach telling them to cast their nets on the other side. And while they're trying to find fish, somehow Jesus already has a fish and he's cooking it. That's a miracle in itself. And so we have that. And then this says many times, many proofs during 40 days, speaking about the kingdom of God. And so that gives us evidence as Christians that Jesus didn't just appear for one day to, you know, in a secret little room where the room was locked and Jesus still appears. It wasn't just that. He appeared to more than 500 people, which is about the size of Edmeston, maybe, depending on the day. So he appeared to a lot of people, which helps give us evidence that it wasn't just a conspiracy theory, that this guy had come back to life. All right, in verse 4, "And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem." We're going to see a map in a second as to why that he wanted them to stay. And it's because to wait for the promise of the Father, which he says is the Holy Spirit. And he says that they will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So this is one instance that Jesus says, in a few days from now, you will be baptized by the Holy Spirit. The next chapter we see it. We also see Jesus supposed to come back. Well, how long do they wait, right? So they're kind of confused as to, well, a few days from now, what does soon mean? But again, we're looking at the main character, the Holy Spirit. All right, verse 5. All right, go back one. So go back to the black screen, please. All right, so kind of to act this out, we have 12 disciples, but there's more than that, and we're going to understand that in a second. But let's picture you were one of the ones that wasn't named the 12, but you followed along, right? You saw Jesus get baptized. You saw him do all these crazy miracles. You saw him, if you were here 2 weeks ago or watched or listened to the message 2 weeks ago in Matthew 23, you saw him really tick off the Pharisees and get them upset, and basically called them sons of Satan, brood of vipers. And so he is going through there. But as you're following Jesus, you're gaining evidence and belief that he might be that promised Messiah. Okay, and as he's getting near the end of his ministry, you're really probably thinking, I think he's the one. I think he's got to be it. And then we have Palm Sunday where he even lets them ride on a donkey and say he's the king, right? He is okay with it. So it makes sense. Like, he must really be the one. And then he upsets people, and then they crucify him, right? 4 days later, he's on the cross. And we might want to think, oh, I would have still believed in him, but I'm not going to put myself there. I probably would have been like, oh, man, I just wasted 3 years of my life, and this guy died, right? They didn't quite get it. So let's say you're one of those people, and you're still just wondering, is this guy legit? Is he real? He's dead. Easter, right? Resurrection Sunday. Amen. He is risen. Or he is risen, and then he is risen indeed is what I think we're supposed to say. That's okay. But right, we should be excited. And from before Easter, I was telling you, we should have more excitement for Easter than we do for Christmas because of how amazing it is. And so he's back to life. And now for 40 days, you still see this guy. So you're faith and trust in who he is has been amplified. Like, he really must be the one, right? So you're super excited, and let's say you've got some buddies, and you're like, how many days has he been alive? 30, 40? Wow. Should we ask him now? No, you do it. And I'm thinking they're going to do rock, paper, or fish, because I don't know if they had scissors yet. They're going to find a way, and one of them has to say, all right, Jesus, it's been 40 days. Now are you going to take the kingdom? Like, now are you going to get Rome out of here and let the Israelites have their own kingdom again? Are you going to be our king? They still didn't get it. But they ask him that. So you can flip into verse 5. And so they're like, or next slide down, I think. Oh, 6. Yeah, thank you. So then they ask him, Lord, will you at this time, right? They're still waiting for him to take over, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? He says, it is not for you to know. And I'm thinking, I would have heard that and not heard the rest of what he said. I'd have been to my buddies, he doesn't think we should know. What's going on? 3 years, you think he'd tell us these things? I'm kind of reading between the lines, follow with me. But he says, it is not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. The disciples still don't get it. All right, continuing on, verse 8. Jesus continues to say, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. In verse 9, and when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took them out of their sight. So they've already seen Jesus go through a locked door. They've seen him do some weird things that normal humans can't do. So again, I'm playing with this a little bit. My picture, are you going to restore the kingdom? Not yet. You're going to get the Holy Spirit. And are you kidding me? Wait, where are you going? Jesus, come back. Is he playing games with us again? Like, what's going on? Where did he just go? And how long do we wait? And it's almost like a phone call. Like, hello, hello, where did you go? And the other line is gone. So the disciples had to be so confused. They're, well, how are we going to get the Holy Spirit if you're not here? Well, it's just a lot of limbo. So as we think about that, the disciples still didn't get it yet. And once they have the Holy Spirit, which is next week, we see that they get it. So Baptists don't talk about the Holy Spirit much. I was always taught as a Baptist that once you start your relationship with Jesus, you have the Holy Spirit. And so I was doing Bible study, and we had a student in our Bible study who grew up the same thought that I did. Then he went off to this different little interesting Bible college. And then he called me one night. He says, Ethan, do you have the Holy Spirit? I was like, yeah, I think so. Yeah, I'm a Christian, so yes, I do. Well, when did you get it? I'm like, oh my goodness, where is he going with this? I don't know. So anyway, he thought that you actually had to have been gifted and someone had to put their hands on you to receive the Holy Spirit. But I didn't know my scriptures. I had read them, but I didn't study them. So I was confused. Well, what does it say? But it made me go look and try to find out and actually study my Bible. And I'm going to say that later, that there's a difference between reading your Bible and studying your Bible. And we're going to see how the disciples really knew their Bible. All right, so verse 10. And while they were gazing into heaven, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way you have seen him, you saw him go into heaven. So I'm picturing one of the scenarios that we're going to look at later. One of the people that we don't want to be is sometimes Christians can think, okay, well, I said the prayer when I was a little kid. I go to church. I take communion. I've even been baptized. And all I'm doing is waiting because I want to get the heck out of earth. Right? I hope we're not that Christian, but we've done the bare minimum, and we're just sitting there looking up. God, are you coming yet? Because stuff's getting crazy. And all we're focused on is God coming back to save us. Hopefully that's not us. But that could be. It could be us. We're not focused around all the chaos around us and how God wants us to show his love there. We're just focused on God coming back. Hopefully that's not us. All right, let's go to the next slide. Should be okay. All right, so Acts 1:8 says you will receive the Holy Spirit. Wait, hold on, make sure I don't mess that up. Yep, but you will receive power when you receive the Holy Spirit, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And I always just thought, oh, great, some cities. I don't know where they are. But if we look at the map, you've got the inner circle. That small one is Jerusalem. And that is the epicenter of religion for the world. You've got almost 2 billion Christians and Jews that would say that is the center. You also have 1.9 billion Muslims who think that is the center of the religious world. Very important place. So he says, in all Jerusalem. And he has just told them to stay in Jerusalem till they get the Holy Spirit. And as you read through the book of Acts, you're going to see they start there. And then they kind of get spread out a little bit more. And then eventually they start getting persecuted, which is a blessing because it makes them spread out even more. So as we look at these, you can hit the next, actually go one slide. So Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth. And hit one more slide, and we're going to see New York. So what does this affect us, right? Where is our Jerusalem? Well, Edmeston, right? We're Second Baptist Church of Edmeston. This is our Jerusalem. And within that, I tried the second circle, tried to get the Edmeston School District in a circle, but maybe that's our the next circle. And then the bigger circle. And I know we have got some people that are going to Alaska, right, on a missions trip. And so for that, that would be the ends of the earth. I don't have a huge, I wish I had a 3D model of the world and multiple circles in it, but I don't today. But just a question for you is, God wants us to be doing things specifically starting in our Jerusalem, in Edmeston. And so some questions would be, do your neighbors know that you're a Christian? Do your neighbors know that that you believe in Jesus? Are some great questions. So for me, I was a Christian. I went to a Christian college in Ohio, then I went to a Christian college in Texas, and then I transferred to a state university in New York. And so I've been all across this country studying. And inside of that, when I went to Brockport, I got involved in a ministry. And it was the first time I was at a Bible study with students who actually wanted to be there. In youth group, parents drop them off because they're supposed to go. At a Christian college, you had to go to chapel 38 times a semester, swiping your card into chapel and out of chapel. If you weren't there for 75% of the time and didn't make 33 chapels, you're on academic probation. So you had to go. And when I went to the state college, it was the first time in my life Bible study was awesome because people were there asking questions because they really wanted to know. So I loved it, and it really helped me just start getting into Bible study and spreading the word at that campus. And then all of a sudden, there was a lady from China who showed up to do ministry. And I said, what are you doing here? We're sending people over there. And she said, well, in my town in China, Christianity is growing, and we heard America has problems. And I thought about it, and I go, wait, America has forgotten about our Jerusalem. We've forgotten about ourselves. We've sent people out, which is what we're supposed to do, but we're not an American nation or a Christian American nation anymore. And so it just made me rethink at that time, wow, God is sending people here to fix us or to help us, point us to Jesus. That shouldn't be the case if we're such a great Christian place. And so as a young man, I'm trying to understand this. And that really helped me. There's a verse in Matthew that says, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. And that verse got to my heart. And that's what made me say, I love computer programming. I got a comfortable job at Brockport, but I think God wants me to do campus ministry. So I took my wife of only 10 months being married, and she'd never even been on a plane before, grew up in West Edmonton. I took her to downtown Minneapolis, and we did ministry there for 10 years. And then we came back 2 years ago. But anyway, but in that, think about your Jerusalem, Edmonton. Are we making a difference here? And I love this church because you've got the food bank, and that does multiple. That at least does the first two circles, right? There's ways that this church is making a difference. But just something to think about, right? Are we waiting for Jesus, or are we, as we see next week, are we going to use the Holy Spirit to help us understand how we're supposed to be involved in reaching these circles? Something to think about. All right, we're going to continue on with the next part. So a question is, how many of you as a family, and maybe some of you on the online might fit this, how many of you got all dressed for church and said, all right, we're going to flip a coin today? If it's heads, we go to church. If it's tails, God doesn't want us to go to church. You're going to understand why I'm talking about this. And you flipped it up and, what is it? And maybe your four-year-old says, it's tails. All right, go back to bed. Turn the TV on. We're not going to do it. God doesn't want us to go to church. You might say, Ethan, why are you talking about this? Well, what is casting lots? Right? It's talked about it here, and this is the last time in Scripture we see casting lots. And in a similar way, that's what would happen with casting lots. And so we're going to get into that in a second. But in a lot of times, we see some things happen that we don't necessarily do. And I don't think that casting lots, or I don't think that you should flip a coin to decide whether you should go to church. We can have fun with that conversation another time. All right, so verse 12. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. So if you are a good Jew, on the Sabbath, there's only so far you're allowed to travel. If not, it's considered work, and you're not supposed to work. There's only so much you can do. So within Minneapolis, there's a certain little suburb community that was where all the Jews live, because that's where their worship center is. And so to go there, you can't drive, you can't work. So you all live within a certain area so you can go there. So that is why it tells us that Olivet on the map. I didn't have time to put an extra map up today. But it just tells us again, that tells us it could have only, but they could have only gone so far away from Jerusalem at this time. So they come back, and when they entered, they went up to the upper room. So again, they're in Jerusalem. I showed a quick glimpse of the video of the city a couple weeks ago. And while they were there staying, so real quick, before we read this, how many of you could have told me the 12 disciples' names without looking in the book? So I quizzed the Monday nights over at the Flats. We've got a kids ministry going on, and I've got 5th through 10th grade in my group. And I quizzed them, and I even said, we can do open book. Where would you go? Because I want to know where they're at and how familiar were they. And some of them were like, I think it's in the New Testament. And so anyway, just something to think about is how well do we know our Bible? All right, so when they entered, they were in the upper room, and then it gives us the names of the 11 that are left. I'm going to continue on to the next page, verse 14. All of these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. So I want to really focus on this verse. So one of the options is we can be the Christian that has done the bare minimum, we think, to become a Christian, and we're just staring into heaven waiting for Jesus to come back. Or this is one of the other options. All of these were with one accord devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. How many times have we devoted a specific time to prayer? In our campus retreats, we often have a block of time. In this one, when I took, I think, 5 students from Minnesota to Arizona to our other ministry, and we had 4-hour block to spend time with God, reading your Bible, praying, and we had a couple different spiritual electives or options, or guided things. And my one student, after 20 minutes, he was done. He's like, I can't do this. I was like, yeah, if you've never done it before, it's interesting. How would you devote time to God? So if I'm devoted at work, well, that means I'm spending at least 40 hours, right? What does it mean to be devoted to prayer? I think it's all something we can be challenged by. How do we devote ourselves to prayer? So for our families, how would we set a certain specific time aside, maybe a certain night of the week, to pray? Or maybe with your spouse, setting a certain time to be devoted to prayer. And it wasn't just the men, or just the 11 or 12, but all of them, and it says about 120. So could 120 people fit in this room? Probably, right? This is a pretty big room back then in Jerusalem. This would have been, and it's an upstairs room, so this would have been a fairly large facility where they were staying. So I have mentioned briefly, but when I was in Minneapolis, I spent the first 5 years just focused on teaching and discipling Christians, and then God really gave me a heart specifically for Muslims in Minneapolis. There's over 250,000 Muslims in Minnesota, and I realized that no one was reaching them. So anywhere you go, I go to the playground, they're often sitting by themselves or playing by themselves. So I would take my kids and go over there and talk to them, and I learned certain things. I'd say, wassalamu alaikum, which means a greeting to them. They have to respond. It would be a sin almost if they didn't respond to me. So by saying 2 words in Arabic opens up a conversation, because they'll immediately say, are you a Muslim? No, I'm not. I'm a follower of Isa, because you don't say you're a Christian, because they've already got an image of what that means, and it's not a good one. And I say a follower of Isa. Isa is Jesus in Arabic. And I've had amazing hour-long conversations with dads at a playground who are Muslim about our faith. And something I realized is I could learn something from them about their faith. Five times a day they pray, and during Ramadan, which is their holy week, I like to explain it, that's their Easter for 30 days. Okay, they celebrate, they fast from sun up to sundown. They got five prayer times. Our house was two blocks away from the mosque, and I religiously at midnight would walk my dog for maybe an hour, and I would always walk by there and pray. But during Ramadan, there would be over 80 cars at 1 a.m. for their prayer time. And I just thought about, when's the last time I saw Christians get together past 7 p.m. to pray? And I'm not saying anyone's wrong, but it just made me realize, wow, how devoted am I in my prayer life? They're devoted, especially during the Ramadan time. But there's times when I eventually started having God give me enough courage to go into the mosque and actually pray with them. I'm praying to Jesus, and they knew I was not a Muslim. But we had conversations. That was one of the scariest things I've done. But I felt the Holy Spirit wanted me to do that, and we'll get more into the Holy Spirit next week. So anyway, devotion to prayer. What does your prayer life look like? Would your spouse say that you have a devoted prayer life? You don't have to answer those questions, but just something to think about. How devoted are you to your prayer life? All right, continue on. Verse 15, in those days, Peter stood up among the brothers. The company was about 120. He said, brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke beforehand by the mouth of David. So again, the Holy Spirit was active in the Old Testament. Right here's the example. And earlier it said that Jesus spoke through the Holy Spirit. So we have the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament and the New Testament. By the mouth of David concerning Judas. So how many of you would have just, by reading, known, oh, I could go read what David said about Judas? Or we're going to see in a second, how many of you would have thought, oh, I'm going to go read the Psalms because that's a prophecy about Judas? I wouldn't have. I'm not special. I've been many years in seminary, but it wouldn't have been the first place I would have gone. So even for me, the more I study the scripture, the more I realize I don't know it as well as I want. So there's a difference between reading the scriptures and studying it. So in Minneapolis, there was an IKEA store there. And so many of you have had those particle board cabinets or desks or dressers that are cheap for starter, you know, newly married couples. And so we would get some of those things, and you try to read the directions, right? And say, take bolt C with washer F and put it into the side of L. And if you just read it and didn't look at everything, just read it, I could finish it. But then if I went over here to actually put it together, I would have no clue, right? But if I really studied it and realized, oh, they're trying to put the top together with the big bolts and the legs together with the small bolts, but the lock washer. Like if I could understand some concepts, then I went over, I might be able to put it together. Because I've tried to do it without the directions, and did they send extra bolts? Or did I miss something, right? And so again, there's a difference between reading our scripture and really studying it. And we find that the disciples knew their Old Testament super well. Well enough to know that, hey, this we need to do this because it says in Psalms that his office needs to be, we're almost there, hold on. So over to the next page, please, next slide. Yep. For he was numbered among us, and talking about Judas, we could have a whole week or two on Judas. It was allotted his share in ministry, parentheses, now this man acquired a field with the reward of his wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open the middle, and all his bowels gushed out. We're not eating, so we can do that. We can talk about this. But something for you to look up, if you're one that likes to look up, did Judas die by suicide or by falling out? So scripture mentions two options, and is that a contradiction? I want you to look at that, because I don't have time to do it today, but if you want to talk about it, I'd love to. All right, verse 19. And it became known to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem. So that field was called in their own language Al-Kadama. That is field of blood. So again, they knew who Jesus was, but everyone also knew who betrayed that man. Right? All of Jerusalem. And it was predicted that at least 1 million people were probably there during that week, that holy week of Palm Sunday into Easter. And so everyone knew, not just that he died, but that he rose, but they also knew that you don't even want to go near that field because of what had happened and what that man had done. So he says in verse 20, for it is written in the book of Psalms, may his camp become desolate and let there be no one to dwell in it, and let another take his office. They knew their scriptures very well. Psalms, in seminary, we had to read each book in one sitting. Luckily, we convinced the professor that we wouldn't have to read all of Psalms in one sitting, because it took about almost 6 hours to get through Genesis in one sitting. So the Psalms, those ones are rough. Yeah, I thought it was rougher than Leviticus, but that's my opinion. All right, so the next one, so 21. So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning at the baptism of John until the day he was taken up from us, one of these men must become with us a witness to his resurrection. So again, this tells us that there was more than just 12 disciples. At one point it says there's 72. I think in Luke 7, there's all kinds of followers, and that's when he talked about the cost of discipleship, and some of them walked away. But there were still some that weren't called, weren't officially chosen, that were still there. And so they're saying, hey, we need someone to replace us, and he's even saying the book of Psalms says that we need to replace us, replace Judas. And so they do something weird, right? They cast lots. So the other time in Scripture we see casting lots is 40 days before, when Jesus is crucified, they cast lots to get his robes or his clothes. And then we see it in the Old Testament, oftentimes within the Jewish temple area. And so I was watching a Jewish rabbi explain it, and he would say, you might have 8 staff with Pastor Andy if this was our church, but we don't want to show favoritism as to who gets to lead more often. So Pastor Andy might come out and say, all right, put up a hand, and you could put up 5, 4, 3, 1. You had to at least put one finger up, and Pastor Andy might say to Danny, 62. So everyone put their finger up, and he would just continue to count until he got the 62nd finger, and that person would lead the morning worship. So the idea is it's unbiased. There's no favoritism in the choice, but we see it also as they would pray about it and say, God, you know the heart, who might you have? So they were kind of giving an unbiased option to God, and God would use it. We see Gideon throwing out a fleece, right? Like, make everything damp, but not this. Oh, give me another sign, do it again. And so these are some times where we would ask God to intervene into something. But this is the last time we see it. And the reason, I think, is because after this, in the next chapter, we have the Holy Spirit. So we have that in us to help us. And that is the part, is for me as a young Baptist, I was so confused about, because we didn't talk about it much. So again, come next week. That's my teasing for that. All right, so and they prayed. They had the two. We're going to call him Justice, because he's got 3 names. Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also called Justice. We got Justice and Matthias. And they prayed and said, you, Lord, who know the hearts of all, show which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place. And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11. So we can think about Matthias, but instead let's look at Justice. He wasn't picked. For 3 years, he still followed Jesus around. He was there at the baptism. He was there, assuming, at the death, the resurrection, and even the ascension. But he wasn't picked. And so I think let's talk about that more, because a lot of people think, oh, well, I wasn't called to be a pastor. Maybe I wasn't called to be the Sunday school leader. So it's not my responsibility. But I doubt that Justice would have just walked away because he wasn't called. Right? I think that he would have continued to do the things that the disciples did. He would have followed along and continued, and hopefully he wouldn't have been a sore, poor sport, right, just because he wasn't picked. And so I think that sometimes us as Christians, we can think, I'm not the pastor, that's not my job. Or it's my pastor's job to invite my neighbor to church. But what about Justice? Maybe we can be that person. We can be the Justice who we didn't get called. But does that mean that we don't still have the responsibility to be a disciple of Jesus? So I think that we're all in ministry, and it's a mindset we need to think about, is that my wife is part of my ministry. My kids are part of my ministry. Obviously, my college students in my ministry are part of my ministry. But I'm also a deacon at our church. Well, the church is also my ministry, the people. And so for even if you don't have a title, I want to challenge you to think of who is in your ministry that God's given you. Who is in your Jerusalem? Who's in your Judea? Who's in your Samaria? So to summarize this, if your neighbor sees you today all dressed up nice, or especially last week, we were probably dressed up even nicer, and they see you get out of your car and walk into your house, what might they think? Do they see a Christian who doesn't care about them and is just waiting for Jesus to come back to save them? Do they see a Christian who still doesn't understand what Jesus is about? Those disciples that were like, are you still going to take over the kingdom? Or the other option, maybe you're a Christian who's upset because you didn't get to go on that missions trip. Maybe they see a Christian who's just going through the motions. Or the fourth option would be, maybe they see a Christian who is devoted to prayer and more than just waiting for Jesus. And next week we would see a fifth option, an option where a Christian who is devoted to prayer and filled with the Holy Spirit. So that's something to think about, and I'm pulling out my phone because I have notes. I'm not checking anything else. So think about which of the disciples are you? Have you, at times, are you just waiting for Jesus to come back? Or do you feel that the Holy Spirit is inside of you and is prompting you to look at these circles, the Jerusalem, the Edmeston School District, the county you live in? So I like to tell my college students that God has created them for a reason, and they got to figure out what that reason is. Oftentimes a college student thinks, I don't need to get involved in a church because I'm only here for 2 years. I'm only here for 4 years. Later in life, I will give time to God. And I like to tell them, wait, you're here for a reason, though. God created you the way you are and put you where you are for a reason. So we want to ask God to give us the guidance so we understand what is it he has for us. So I just want to challenge you to take some time to think, who is it that God wants you to be investing into? Maybe it's spending more time with your family in the Word of God. Maybe it's more than just hi to your neighbor, but coronavirus, hopefully, as things are getting eased up, coronavirus has made it very hard to love on our neighbors, but challenge yourself, what can you do to those that you can see from your house, your neighbors, that could be more than just praying for them? Ask the Holy Spirit to move inside you to do these things. So I just want to challenge you, what is your response as we're waiting for Jesus to come back? Is it just focused on him coming back, or are you going to ask the Holy Spirit to give you the power to do the things that are uncomfortable and hard to do? Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for the book of Acts and how it helps us see the mind of the disciples better as they're in confusion, waiting, trying to understand what things look like. When are you coming back? But Lord, as we're going to see next week, you give us the most precious gift in a couple ways. You give us Jesus, but you also give us the Holy Spirit to help us be in connection with you and help us decipher the scriptures and help us to make decisions. So we ask that you would let us be aware and in tune with you through the Holy Spirit, and we ask that you could be with us this week and help us understand and be aware of who you have in our ministry, right in our neighborhood, in our communities, in our workplaces, and wherever that might be. So we just ask you would give us guidance as we go from here. In your name, amen.